Hello, everyone. I'm Trish Davidson. I'm the Dean of the School of Nursing, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to our inaugural Nursing Grand Rounds. And so before we go into our session today, I just really want to thank many people behind the scenes. We've already mentioned Rafe and Florentina, but in particular, Mickey Goodwin and Diana Baptiste, and also our development and alumni team who have worked hard to make sure that we have not only a very stimulating and meaningful program, but also that this will be counted as part of continuing nursing education. One of the silver linings of the pandemic has been, in particular, our increased connectivity with our alumni and also across the healthcare system. I also, for anyone who is their first time in engaging in a School of Nursing virtual event, please keep your eyes open also for our Chief Nursing Officer rounds, which are also another great way to engage with the school, engage across the Hopkins community, and also within this challenging time of COVID, make sure that we're more connected. When we were thinking about how we would start nursing grand rounds, I talked to my colleagues that, you know, one thing that I've been a nurse for 40 years and been to many, in particular, medical grand rounds. Many of the medical grand rounds, I think, you know, focus on the weird and the wonderful. It's often the really unusual case. But so much of the work of what nurses do is dealing with common but wicked problems. That is, their reasons for these problems are multifactorial, multi-sectoral in their influence, and really hard to achieve. And in particular, in the COVID-19 pandemic, many of the issues that are meaningful to us have been amplified and accentuated. And so I think it's really timely and relevant that today that we focus on a very common problem and also a very wicked problem. And today we have two international experts to help us understand this really complex issue a little bit more. And also our team really wants, within our Nursing Grand Rounds series, to focus on nursing as a force for good and a force for change. So today, as we focus on some very complex issues and we get to hear from Dr. Campbell and Dr. Sakran, I think it's really timely and appropriate that we all come together at this really challenging time. Firstly, to really offer our thoughts and commitment to doing better to the over 200,000 American lives who have been lost in this pandemic. Many of them have been healthcare workers. And we know for each and every one of those numbers that we see in the tallies, there are families that are grieving deeply. I think I also, within the context of this discussion today, that is really going to look at violence more broadly, both within the context of gun violence, but also intimate partner violence, is that we truly celebrate the life of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and really take strength from her great work. And so many of the issues that are going to be covered today, really from looking at issues in the constitutions around the rights to bear arms, about the roles of women in society, and really social justice and human rights, I think that it's also really appropriate today that we think about the great legacy of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. So, as I mentioned today, we are really very grateful to have two exceptional experts who are going to help us to think a little bit about what is the nurse's role in preventing, managing, and mitigating violence. And so today, it's my great delight to be able to welcome Dr. Joseph Sakran from the School of Nursing and our very own Dr. Jackie Campbell to tackle these really complex issues. And I think in particular for all of the nurses today, attending nursing grand rounds. Sometimes these issues seem so complex, so big, and we think, how can I, as an individual nurse working on a clinical unit or a nursing student in school, make a difference to this very complex and wicked problem? And I'm really hoping today you'll be motivated and inspired and called to action from our stellar speakers. This is such a very important issue that is very near and dear to our hearts. We know that just over the last few weeks in Baltimore, we have seen many shootings and many deaths, and even an accidental death of a three-year-old in East Baltimore who shot himself because the gun was not stored appropriately. So as you can see, there is many issues within this story that are appropriate and relevant to nursing. Just before I introduce Dr. Sakran, I would just really want to remind people that in order to be eligible for the CNE credit, you need to stay for the entirety of the program and also complete a questionnaire online. So now it's my great pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Joe Sakran, who's going to needs little introduction, but maybe I can tell you a little bit about how I stalked Joe Sakran on Twitter. I have been incredibly amazed and inspired by his courage, his ability, in the words of RBJ, to disagree without being disagreeable. And I know that he is, because of his brave and courageous stance, has been subject to death threats and other just unspeakable things. So it takes a huge amount of energy and compassion to really work in this field. So after being a stalker for a little while on Twitter, I worked up the courage to email him, and we have been plotting together over the last year or so on making good trouble. So over to you, Joe, and thanks so much for all of the work you do. And we're really very, very grateful for you making the time for us here today. Thank you.
Well, let me see here. I'm going to share my screen. Okay, great. Let me just first start by thanking you, Dean Davidson. It has been just such an incredible pleasure and honor to get to know you over this past year. And, you know, when I got that email from the dean, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm like, the dean is emailing me, what did I do wrong or what's happening? And we just had literally the most lovely conversation, and that conversation turned into something that has really been both mentorship and friendship in honestly an unexpected way. To think that, you know, someone of her level is willing to just reach out and help pay it forward and figure out how do we collaborate and how do we work on these complex health issues together has meant so much. And I don't think I really even have the words to articulate what it's meant to me personally. I'll tell you, being part of this Grand Rounds and this inaugural event and being here with my friend, an expert, Dr. Campbell, is also a great pleasure. And specifically within the School of Nursing, I come from a family that's peppered with nurses. And as a clinician and a trauma surgeon, I truly do not think I would be where I currently am today had it not been for the so many the nurses that have impacted how I think, how I treat patients, and how I continue to move forward even despite some of the most horrific things that we see. I've always said that, you know, the nurses are the glue that holds us together. And so thank you so much. It's such a privilege and an honor to be here with all of you. Look, I can't begin this discussion without really telling you my own personal story and how I got here. I was born just outside our nation's capital, the son of immigrant parents that came to this country in search of those hopes and dreams I think that so many of us strive for. And at the age of 17, my life really changed after I went from being a healthy high school student to collateral damage after I was shot in the throat with a .38 caliber bullet. And it's hard to really start this conversation around gun violence in America without telling you my own story and highlighting really the two individuals, Dr. Bob Ahmed on the left and Dr. D. Mukherjee on the right, who along with their teams gave me this second chance at life. And I don't know how many of you were at the age of 17, but I love this Brad Paisley song where he says, at 17, it's hard to see past Friday night. And I think, you know, what he means is that a lot of us at that age, we're living day in and day out. And we don't realize the fact that we're mortal. We may not even appreciate the people we have in our life. And frankly, most of us have no idea what we're going to do for the rest of our careers. And that was pretty much me. And so I wouldn't be here today without the incredible family that have really been there by my side through all the ups and downs, and all the mentors that continue to guide me. Just a couple disclosures. I try to talk about this way, as the dean alluded to, in the most objective of ways. I think it's important to recognize, as a victim of gun violence, that there is in each of us an implicit bias. And so I recognize that despite trying to be objective, I have my own biases towards this issue. And then I'll just say, like so many of you, this is personal as a clinician, as someone who cares for these injured patients and families, frankly, day in and day out, especially in cities like Baltimore. So we're gonna quickly outline the scope of the problem. We're gonna, you know, talk about the situation nationally and some of the challenges moving forward. And we're gonna end in a little bit of a different way about being able to tell your own story. And I think you'll see why that's so important. And really, I think, you know, the need for real leadership in this country. So I was in the fire department during college. I'd gone through fire school. My parents were super nervous. They thought I would never go to medical school because I loved it so much. And this picture was taken. And some of you are probably looking at this picture and thinking, oh, look, there's Joe, another photo op as the building behind him burns down. But perception is not always reality. And the reality of this situation is this was a training exercise. And so we had come out of the building and the other team had gone in. And I show this only to highlight the fact that as we talk about these issues that are so emotionally charged, that are so complex, it is critical for us to hold our judgment. Meaning, I'm sure all of you have experienced this. You walk into a meeting, someone says something that you may not necessarily agree with. What happens when that scenario takes place? Well, you stop listening to them, and we know that, you know, 90% of communication is nonverbal. And you don't only stop listening to them for that one instant, but for future scenarios where you remember, oh, that's the person that said something I don't necessarily agree with. And so I think it's important for us to hold our judgment and really think about this in a very objective manner. When we're talking about the epidemiology of gun violence in America, this is not a random thing that we are seeing. Every day, there are over 300 people shot. And for the 100 plus deaths, it's so critical to know that for every one of those deaths, there's about 2 to 3 injuries. And those numbers are probably conservative because depending upon the state that you live in or the trauma center that you're a part of, they may or may not collect all those injuries that are coming through the door. And so, you know, that gets us talking a little bit about data, and we'll talk about that in a second. This also affects young people. And you might not be surprised that 1 out of 3 children have guns in the home, right? With the number of firearms that we have in our country, that might not be a surprise. But I think what you should be surprised at is that there are nearly 4.6 million children that live in homes with unlocked and loaded weapons. And you can talk to any responsible gun owner and they'll tell you that's just completely unacceptable. When you look at the breakdown, one of the other things that people don't often talk about is the fact that 2/3 of the firearm-related deaths come from suicide, with the other major chunk being homicide, and then the minority unintentional injuries and a few other things within that category. I say unintentional injuries specifically because none of these are accidents. We should never really use the word accident because it implies that the event is not preventable. And so from a public health perspective, I really try to avoid that. When you look at how the homicide rate is broken across age and gender, what you will notice is that there is a significant disparity that exists, especially as you start talking about race. So this is all ages and gender, and you can see it's about 4.5 per 100,000. When you look at white males, you can see that that number drops. Okay, what happens when we look at young white males? Okay, that's gone up. What about looking at black males? What about young black males? So you can see that there is a disparity that exists as you break this across race. And one of my colleagues, Dr. Campbell from San Francisco General, he was on call the day the YouTube shooting happened where they got a couple people that had come in. And he came out of the hospital and he saw all these reporters there. And he was surprised to see them. And he said to them, "Where were you yesterday when 4 black men came into my trauma center?" And the point is that a lot of these high profile shootings or the mass shootings will get significant media attention. But the reality is that's the minority of the epidemic that we are facing in this country. And we have young brown and black men in cities like Baltimore that are being killed on a daily basis. And those stories are not being told. So we have, I think, both an opportunity and the responsibility to tell those stories. We wrote a paper looking at this public health problem a number of years back. And one of the points that we wanted to make is highlight this myth of mental health that exists. Only 4% of violence is actually associated with one of the major mental illnesses, whether it's bipolar disease or schizophrenia or depression. Now, we know there is a high correlation of mental illness and suicides, right? But actually, individuals with mental illness are more likely to be victims than perpetrators. And I think that's important. And as we talk about the suicide piece, it's also important that we have seen suicide related to firearms increase over the past decade by 19%. And you can see that here outlined in the graph. Whereas we have traditionally seen over the past 10 to 20 years, the homicide rate continue to head in a downward slope. Now, that has changed recently, and I think it's still too early to see how that's all going to play out. The reason suicide is so important is because the majority of people, right, after a suicide attempt, do not go on to die from a second attempt, right? So if they survive that first attempt, the majority of them go on to die from, you know, things that all of us will probably succumb to. And so why is that then conversation important as we talk about it in relation to firearms? Well, it's because we know that the fatality rate of a suicide attempt when you use a firearm is extremely high. And you can see that the majority of fatal suicide attempts happen when a firearm is used. The other thing that we know is that when you look at the decision-making process from the time someone decides to attempt suicide till they actually follow through with that, 70% happen within that first hour. And so that's important as we look at this from a prevention perspective and how we think of really when are we going to intervene and act. We know that acting after they've made the decision is probably too late, right? So trying to think about some of those early warning signs is going to be critical. And finally, I'll just say, if the human toll is not enough for you, well, there's also an economic burden. We published this a couple of years ago, looking at the mean charges, both if you come into the emergency department and are discharged, and if you come in and are admitted. And you can see the numbers there with the annual number of about $2.8 billion. Now, this is very important because this is not the societal cost, right? This is just, you know, a very honestly, a very crude way that we tried to figure out, like, what are some of the hospital charges? And those of you that have done work on cost and charges, you know, this is very difficult to do. When you look at the societal cost, meaning, you know, are they going to be able to go back to work? Are they going to be on a ventilator for life? We know that that number is at least $174 billion. There's some reports around $230 billion a year. I mean, look at what we are spending to educate our kids in this country. And look at what we're spending on cost of firearms. It's just unacceptable. I'm not going to discuss this in detail, but I just want to briefly talk about the public policy approach, and we can get into this a little bit more during our question and answer session. But, you know, there's this polarization of this topic around guns in America. And Adam Winkler wrote this great book about called Gunfight, and really talking about whether or not this is part of our, you know, American culture. And I think one of the things that I've realized is that as Americans, we have a lot more in common than we have that divides us. And I have seen this, whether it's, you know, talking to, you know, people in Kansas or Texas, gun owners often will come up to me and say, you know, Joe, I agree with the majority of what you are saying. And I think we have to be willing to have those difficult conversations and to have them in non-emotional ways and figure out where are the commonalities that exist that unite us as individuals. I think we also have to look at this from a public health lens. This is not the first time we have had to deal with public health problems. You look at motor vehicles and fatalities that were happening in the 60s and 70s. We didn't get rid of cars. We came up with things like seatbelts and airbags, and we made roads safer, right? It's that same type of approach of being able to move away from trying to focus simply on human behavior, which we know is not cost effective, and to focus on making a system where it makes it less likely that someone will be injured. Great work from the Gun Violence Center at the School of Public Health, where they have put out, you know, data that again shows the commonality that exists among the American public, among gun owners, among NRA members, and these numbers are even higher. You see this Fox poll that recently showed 90% of Americans in favor of background checks. I can't think of anything that, you know, 90% of Americans agree upon. Yet there's still that hesitancy to move forward, and we can talk a little bit about that. When you look at like states that are licensed for professional haircutters, and I got this from Jan Vernick, I thought it was a very creative outline, right? You guys are not here with me, but if you think about how many states actually require you to have a license, you may not be surprised that it's all of them. But when you look at firearm dealer license and state laws, you can see the disparity there. Why is the license piece important? Meaning, why is it important for you as a purchaser to be required to have a license? Well, it does a couple things. The first is you have to file an application to law enforcement. So people that are bad actors are maybe not that willing to proceed and to do that. The second is it usually allows for more time from a background check perspective versus the typical 3 days that we hear about. And some of you are probably familiar with the Charleston loophole and how that perpetrator was able to get a firearm because the background check didn't come back within those 3 days and they had to sell that person the firearm. There's also a fingerprinting component, so it's much more accurate than simply giving them your name and date of birth. And then some states also require verification of safety training. So you can see why that may be useful. When you look at this from a public policy perspective in this country, again, it is so difficult to change policy, and really, it's probably due to two different factors. Number one, the structure of our government, right? And how, you know, frankly, the number of votes you need in the Senate in order to get stuff passed, but also the effectiveness of our gun lobby. And I want to be very clear about this. I mean, we've seen this in situations like Citizens United. Money has impacted this conversation. And so, you know, that's something that we can kind of get into, but I don't think we should underestimate the impact of dollars and how it has swayed a lot of our elected officials. You know, I just want to, you know, finally, like, talk a little bit about the importance of research. And I think when you're looking at research, it's been very clear. I think this was probably one of the first pieces by Dr. Kellerman that showed the relationship of both suicide as well as homicide as it relates to gun ownership. And this piece was so important because it got the attention of NRA. And what happened was it led to this Dickey Amendment, which I think many of you have heard of, where essentially Congress ended up shifting $2.6 million away from the CDC. Now that number, by the way, is not random. That is the amount of money they had spent in the year prior studying firearm prevention. And when you look carefully at the amendment actually doesn't say you can't study gun injury. It just says that you can't use those dollars to advocate or promote gun control. Yet, you know, when you talk to people on both sides, you talk to the CDC, they say, hey, we're happy to study it. But as soon as they appropriate the dollars and Congress says, oh yeah, they're, you know, more than welcome to do it, but they never actually give them the dollars. Until recently, you know, some of you may have heard that for the first time in over 20 years, the CDC and NIH were given a small amount of money to study firearm injury prevention. That has not been renewed and something that will be, you know, a continued discussion. But it's important because as you look at some of the other diseases that we fund and you look at their, you know, impact on society, I mean, most of us probably have not dealt with any individuals with these disease processes, right? Look at firearm injury and look at the number of grants compared, and this is before the most recent funding, right? But the number of grants compared to the impact from a morbidity and mortality perspective. It's just not comparable. I just want to end by saying, you know, as healthcare workers, as clinicians, we sometimes are really just focused on the data and the science. And the data and the science is super important. But the data and the science, they don't change the hearts and minds of people. And so figuring out how to tell your story, right, is so critical. And each and every one of us, we have a story, and it doesn't have to be as dramatic as being shot in the throat. And I think we've seen professions wake up and start talking about this issue. We saw, you know, the This Is Our Lane movement where healthcare workers said, no, actually, we do have a role in coming up with the solutions. And that led to incredible collaboration across medical organizations all across this country that really came out with some real solid public health interventions and collaborations. And I think that, you know, it's hard to talk about this subject without talking about one of my former professors, Dr. Marshall Yans, who is probably the world expert in public narrative. And he talks about the story of self, the story of us, and the story of now. And the point is that in order to go from value to action, it's done through emotion. It's done by being able to tell your story, whether it's a patient you've taken care of, your own personal experience. That's what moves the needle forward. And it really, you know, always gets me thinking about this golden circle. And if you haven't seen this TED Talk, I highly recommend it. But this is really, you know, Simon Sinek does a great job about telling people, like, it's about the why. If you can get people to believe in what you believe in, then you've sold them. And when you look at really successful companies, you know, like Apple, for example, right? They don't like get you on board because they're convincing you, you know, what they're doing. They're convincing you why they're doing it. This is one of my perhaps favorite pieces in the Harvard Business Review. And it's a piece about leadership, and it talks about, you know, how well do people lead? And it really followed 10,000 West Point cadets throughout their career. And they looked at internal motivators and external motivators. So like internal motivators being things like, you know, someone feeling the purpose to serve, right? And external, those individuals that like were initially got into it because maybe they were getting student loans or whatever. You may not be surprised that those that were driven by purpose and passion actually had more successful careers. And again, there's a lot of ways you can define success, but something just to keep in the back of your mind as you think about your own professional path and how you're moving forward. You know, since Parkland, there's been over 1,200 kids that have been shot and killed. And I just think that that's just unacceptable. As one of, you know, the greatest nations in the world, this should not be happening, and this is preventable. And Parkland, I think, was a moment that really re-energized the country. And I think it had a lot to do with young people. I'm just so proud of the young people in this country and being willing and having the moral courage to stand up and to speak out has been so critical. I'll just end with this just final piece. When I was in fellowship at Penn, this is a picture taken in Philadelphia. I don't think I really even understood the power of my own story, to be honest. And we would bring in kids from the community, and we would talk to them and show them the trauma center. And then I would talk to them about gun violence. And this is like one of the first times that I did it. And I'm sitting in this room and I'm talking to these kids about gun violence. And I hadn't told them my own personal story. Now, they're all 14, 15 year olds, so they're kind of paying attention, but you know, not really. And then I told them my story, and all of a sudden, all of their eyeballs focused on me. And it was frankly a reaction that I had never seen before, and one that I wasn't expecting. And what it taught me was, in that moment, I went from being this person wearing a white coat to someone that could relate to these kids, to what they've been through, to what they continue to see daily within their own communities. And I think that's the power of public narrative, and the power of telling your story. So if you're in public life, you have to learn how to tell your story. If you don't, others will. And this doesn't even need a caption, because these kids have done such an incredible job of telling their own story. I'll just leave you with one final thing, which is, you know, what's your story? It's something to think about. I always ask my medical students this. And at the beginning of the rotation, they say, oh, I'm a third year medical student. I'm, you know, in, you know, your surgery rotation right now. And by the end of that rotation, it's completely different, because they understand that I'm trying to figure out who they are and what drives them. I absolutely love what I do. And I can't think of doing anything else that could be more meaningful. But the worst part of my job is having to go out and talk to these mothers and fathers, and to tell them that their child that left that morning is never coming home again. You know, the dean mentioned all of the 200,000 plus individuals that have died from COVID, right? But it's not just those individuals. Each one of those individuals, they have families, they have loved ones. And it's similar in gun violence, in this public health problem, where we are destroying families, communities, and unraveling the fabric of our society. And so it really is incumbent upon us to do everything we can to take an objective, multifaceted approach to try to make communities safer across America. I just want to say that I'm fortunate to be here with you today, and that's because I have incredible partners that are able to cover for me and to continue doing the important work, which is keeping the patient at the center of the equation. And I just want to finally end by acknowledging, you know, the dean, of course, and all her incredible staff that made this happen. But the fact that, you know, I've been so grateful of the relationship that we have built together. And while I'm so thrilled that she recently has had this incredible opportunity to go back home, I'm also sad for myself personally, but also for us as a university and for the School of Nursing, because I think she's going to have really just made such an indelible impact on the School of Nursing and just the Johns Hopkins community. It's going to be really hard to fill her shoes, and we're going to really miss her a lot. Just want to thank my mentors, and just want to thank you all for the opportunity to be with you today. Thanks so much.
Dr. Sakran, thank you so much for an extremely powerful presentation, but more so a powerful personal story that I believe today is a particularly auspicious day. I think it was today, was the day you were actually shot.
Yeah, that's correct. I actually didn't mention that from a time perspective, but so September 23rd, 1994, I mean, I was a high school student at the time, but today is the anniversary, and it was interesting that the staff picked this day. It was obviously a coincidence, but things happen for a reason, and I couldn't think of any other place that I'd love to spend this really kind of impactful day than with all of you. And I think just kind of like the last thing I'll say is that, you know, I never wish anything like this on anyone else, but I also think that the worst day of my life also perhaps was the most impactful, because it led me to what I'm doing today. And, you know, each of you, you have, you know, adversity that you've faced in your own lives, and thinking about how you turn that adversity into something positive, and to channel, whether it's anger or experiences, in a way that can make a difference in other people's lives. You're doing it every day. And I'm just so proud of you guys, and just look forward to a great dialogue and conversation both today and in the future.
Thank you so much. There will definitely be opportunity for dialogue. If you care to look in the chat, there are some very complimentary comments, and then I'll monitor the questions after we move on now. With great pleasure to introduce Dr. Jackie Campbell. Dr. Campbell is a national leader in research and advocacy in the field of domestic and intimate partner violence, IPV. She's authored, co-authored more than 230 publications and 7 books on the topic. And as an educator of nurses and a great mentor, Dr. Campbell leads by example. She's inspiring new generations of nurse researchers. She's on the board of directors for Futures Without Violence. She's an active member of so many groups and committees. I would be remiss if I even called one. So without much further ado, and with great honor, we welcome Dr. Jackie Campbell as our second speaker for this series.
Well, first of all, I would like to say thank you to Joe. It's wonderful to be in the same space with him, and particularly to lead off these nursing grand rounds. I think it's a wonderful tradition, and I look forward to more of these in the future. I also would like to pay tribute to Dr. Davidson and wish her all the best. I know she's going to take over as vice chancellor where she's going, but we will, it will be a big void for us and hard for us to fill. And I wanted to, before I start showing you the slides, I wanted to say to all of you, nurses and other healthcare providers who are out there, that even if you have not been shot, that you as care providers are providing nursing care to people who have experienced gun violence many times, and that your stories about those people can be as powerful, maybe not quite as having been shot yourself. I've not been shot myself, thank goodness. But I have talked to many of the loved ones of, unfortunately, women who have been shot and killed by a partner, and done in-depth interviews with them. So this kind of a story is very powerful also. And I always say when you do policy work, that the combination of stories and numbers, so that you have the data to back it up, the way Joe did, as well as having the stories to tell about people. So let's see if I can make this go down. Oh, I know there's something. Trying to advance the slides. Rafe, where is the?
Okay, so Jackie, try the arrow keys, click on the slide and then hit the arrow key.
Well, that's what I'm doing. Oh, click on the slide. Aha, all right. My area of research where I've done the most work is around domestic violence homicide. And when women are killed in this country, they're most often killed by a husband, boyfriend, or ex. And it's 9 times the rate that are killed by strangers. So we as women, we do a lot about, you know, locking our car doors carefully and walking in well-lit places. And that's all about the stranger in the night, but that's not who's most likely to kill us. And 54 to 56% of those homicides of women by a partner are done with guns. And so the gun issues, some of the things that Joe talked about and many more are very relevant here. The other thing is the number one risk factor for domestic violence homicide is prior domestic violence. And even when a male partner is killed by his female, which doesn't happen nearly as often, but does sometimes happen, there's been prior domestic violence against the female in 75% of those cases. The study I'm going to tell you a little bit about, our National Intimate Partner Femicide Study, 47% of those female victims of homicide by a partner were in the healthcare system before they were killed. And only 4% of them were in touch with any domestic violence services. So that means that those of us who are in the healthcare system, nurses, physicians, other healthcare providers, we need to identify the women who are abused and help them get to appropriate services. Because I firmly believe if more than, you know, that one reason why so many of them were murdered was that they were not in touch with domestic violence services. And that's where we can do the best to do the prevention of the homicide. The other thing that's highly relevant here is that women are far more likely to be the victims of a homicide-suicide. Somewhere around 30%, perhaps even more in recent data, of the homicides of a female partner, the male partner kills himself afterwards. And those dynamics are somewhat different in terms of recognizing that risk. And also importantly, 88 to 94% of those homicide suicides are with guns. So these are some graphics. Every town provided them for me in terms of, based on my own data and other data about domestic violence homicide. So more than half of women are killed by an intimate partner or a family member, far more likely than are to be killed by that than by a stranger. And more than half of them, as I mentioned, are killed with guns. This was a Baltimore Sun editorial, not an editorial, a newspaper story in 2018. But it was the issue was around a school shooting in Maryland of a 17-year-old, a 17-year-old young man killed his girlfriend. His girlfriend was breaking up with him. Now, he killed her with a gun. And again, some of the things that Joe talked about, that we have recently tightened our restrictions on the ability of 16 to 17-year-old to drive by themselves. Why on earth should they be able to access guns without supervision? And he got that gun. It was registered to his father. And yet he was able to get access to that gun, bring it to school, and kill his girlfriend. And so, as Joe mentioned, we have powerful lobbies. And I know when I testified before Congress on these issues, the NRA found me to the extent that I had to totally shut down my email account, et cetera, in terms of the kinds of messages that I was getting. Now, when we talk about femicide, femicide is the murder of women. That's what that word means. And these were the top 10 states in femicide in the most recent reporting. And there's a report that comes out from VPC.org, violencepolicycenter.org, every year about the murder of women. And again, the majority of these women who were killed with guns. These are the top 10 states. If you live in Maryland, you notice Maryland is not on there. It's only been on the top 10 list only 1 year in the prior 10. But still, Maryland does have significant numbers of domestic violence homicide. The other thing that we know that's related to this is that maternal mortality by homicide, which is maternal mortality is death during pregnancy and the first postpartum year. And there's been a lot of attention to these issues because our rates of maternal mortality have actually gone up slightly. And we're one of the leading countries in the world in the Western world, in terms of maternal mortality. Now, official maternal mortality does not include homicide. And there's many of us that feel like it should, that we need to pay attention to that. And a fabulous study was done by Diana Chang and Isabel Horan that was published in 2010 in the Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology that found that if you count homicide as a cause of maternal mortality in Maryland in those years, homicide was the leading cause of maternal mortality, higher than the usual causes, the obstetrical causes that we usually think of in terms of maternal mortality. Firearms were most commonly used in those homicides, 61.8%. The current or former intimate partner was the perpetrator in more than half of these homicides while the woman was pregnant or immediately afterwards. And yet 100% of those victims were in prenatal care. It wasn't that they weren't getting prenatal care, but clearly they were not being identified as the victim of domestic violence enough, and not if those that were the victims of domestic violence beforehand, which we can we can hypothesize was probably true from other data. So it's very important that we do this assessment for domestic violence in prenatal care, in postpartum care, and when a woman comes in for delivery. We have to strategize about how to do that safely without the partner hearing, but we can do that. That's possible to do, and we need to do it at each of those points of care. Again, when we look nationally, the majority of women who are murdered when they're pregnant or immediately after are murdered with guns. Illinois has passed a law now that each state has a maternal mortality review committee. They've passed a law that those review committees have to look at the cases of homicide, not just the cases of other obstetrical causes of maternal mortality. The NVDRS is a wonderful database. In this report that was published was in only of 17 states from 2003 to 2009. And we now have all 50 states. But one of the things that's a problem with the NVDRS, there's a field for if a gun is used in that violent death. And many states are reluctant to enter that gun field because of state laws and around guns and state sentiment that guns aren't something that they want to do anything about at the state level. But in that report, there was 2,900 independent partner homicides. 77% of those were female victims. 54% of those homicides, guns were used. And also there was 38% of those male perpetrators killed themselves afterwards. And in that data, there were even more of those, 88% guns were used. When a male intimate partner killed his wife, girlfriend, or ex, some other family member, most often a child, and then oftentimes kills himself afterwards. We call that familicide. And that also is 88% of those were done with guns. So when we look at the intimate partner homicides over time in this country, and we have passed laws that make it harder for a known domestic violence offender to own a gun. Those laws have been upheld in the Supreme Court. And so because of this, we have decreased the percentage of domestic violence homicides that have been done with guns. But as I've mentioned, it's still the majority. So that decline is in states where there's improved domestic violence laws and resources, where in states where women make more money. And resources does not keep a woman from being abused by a partner, but it gives her more options. And that's why it's important that we pay attention to policy, as RBG would have said, around women's earnings in terms of the prevention of domestic violence homicides, as well as other issues. Also, where there's lower marriage rates, I resonate with Joe's description of being 17, that means where women are less likely to get married early. So our choices of lifetime partners at 17 are not always wise. And so that's part of what goes on there. But most importantly has been that gun availability decline. And there's lots of good data around that. April Zioli, who got her PhD here at Hopkins at Bloomberg, has done some of that research. Shannon Frateroli, who's now at Bloomberg, has done a lot of good studies in terms of the implementation challenges. And And these laws have been upheld by the Supreme Court, but we still have trouble actually implementing them. This is April's work in the American Journal of Epidemiology, basically showing that where we have laws that bar firearms from people who are convicted of a domestic violence misdemeanor or felony, and where orders of protection against domestic violence restrict the ability of the person to possess a gun. Those have resulted in reductions. And I'm not gonna bother you with this, but that Samantha Bee, one of the issues is this boyfriend loophole. In many states, if it's your boyfriend that you have gotten an order of protection against, that he needs to stay away from you, then the gun laws in terms of not allowing that person to possess a firearm do not apply. That's what's called the boyfriend loophole. If you like Samantha Bee, you can find this on YouTube. She explains it all in a very humorous way. I'm also in that YouTube testifying before Congress. So I like that one a lot. It's fairly short. And one of the things in that testimony that's important is many of these laws around guns and domestic violence are state laws. But if we don't have federal laws, and that's what I was testifying about, that it'll be patchwork. And some states will never enact those kinds of restrictions that have been shown to reduce domestic violence homicides. So this is from April's article in terms of the states that have either no laws in red or medium strength laws in pink or strong laws in the light gray. In Maryland, we're in the medium law category. So we'd still have work to do in terms of our laws. So I'm gonna show you just a little bit of data from our domestic violence femicide study, intimate partner femicide study, when we were trying to determine strategies to prevent intimate partner femicide, and it was funded by NIH. And one of the things we found is that the abuser had a firearm. This was a case control study. Amongst the women that were killed, 65% of those abusers owned a firearm. Abused women, same cities, only 24% of their perpetrators of abuse, abusive men, owned a firearm. So abusers that kill are far more likely to own a firearm. 55% of those men had previously used or threatened their victim with a weapon. And only 5% of other abused women in those same cities reported that. And a firearm was used in the most serious incident of abuse before the homicide, 38% of the femicides, only 1% of the other abused women. And showing the same thing graphically, victims owning a gun, and these are victims that were killed or almost killed or abused by their partners, or in the same cities not abused, the victim owning a gun neither increased nor decreased her risk of being killed. And few of them did, but it didn't help them. It didn't prevent them from getting killed if they owned a gun. The abusive man, however, as I mentioned, 74% of them owned a gun before they killed her. 53% of the men who almost killed their partners owned a gun. 27% of abusive men in the same cities, and Baltimore was one of the cities, owned a gun. And only 13% of men who were not abusive, felt it necessarily to own a gun. And I always say, I bet you every single one of these men said they bought that gun to protect their family. But abusers who kill see it more important to have a gun. And according to our data, at least about a third of those abusers should not have owned that gun. They either had a prior domestic violence arrest and conviction or a protective order at the time of the incident. So we did fancy dancy multivariate risk models that I can answer questions about if anybody has it. But what to note is in adjusted odds ratios that perpetrator gun ownership increased the risk of an abusive man killing his partner in 5.4 with an adjusted odds ratio of 5.4 or almost 5.5. And looking at that graphically, we can see that access to a gun is one of the strongest risk factors for an abusive man ending up killing his partner. Using a gun at the time of the incident increased the risk by a ton in turn 24. Adjusted odds ratios. So because a gun is so lethal. And one of the things one of the tragedies here, when you review these homicide records, you see that there might have been an abusive incident, but it might not have been deadly. You know, that if there wasn't a gun there, and as Joe said, a gun, unfortunately, not stored safely. So in the homicide suicides, partner gun ownership increased the risk even more by adjusted odds ratios of 13. So from this study, and I developed the danger assessment far before that, that's the website for the danger assessment. I am very proud that the School of Nursing holds the rights to the danger assessment, to the weighted scoring. That website is maintained by the School of Nursing. And does he own a gun is one of the number two on that danger assessment because it's so important. And it's also an interactive process with women who are abused that aids recall. And we also have on that calendar if there's been a weapon used. And when we did the validation of the danger assessment, we were able to achieve 90% accuracy under the ROC curve. So that means it's accurate. And I'll finish up with the DA5. This is a short form of the danger assessment that is meant for use in the healthcare system. And so there's five items that were some of the strongest on the danger assessment validation. And we've done some other work with a fabulous physician, Carolyn Snyder, in terms of making this short form that can be used in the healthcare system. So first you have to find out who's abused. You need to ask all of your patients, are you being abused by a partner? Or are you experiencing violence from a partner, violence or abuse? I recommend using the word abuse versus violence, that you just ask people. And if they say yes, then you can quickly do this DA5 to identify the ones that are most at risk for a homicide. And then if there are some of those risk factors, if they say some of the ones on the DA5, then it's important that we do the full danger assessment. And for instance, all of the domestic violence advocates at the House of Ruth know how to use the danger assessment, as well as many of our nurses. And the Futures Without Violence website has many good strategies for getting women who are abused to the appropriate resources. So rather than say, here's a phone number for the House of Ruth, instead of that, you say, she's at high risk. Let's make a phone call here. Let's talk to the House of Ruth together. let me, you know, give you a warm, what we call a warm referral to the kinds of services that will be helpful to you. And if you don't want to talk to the shelter, there's a National Domestic Violence Hotline that you can also use. And Nancy Glass's My Plan app, which is also available on part of the Hopkins School of Nursing website, has the danger assessment built into it. So if she says, no, I don't want to talk to anybody. I don't want to, you know, I don't even want to get on anybody's website. And you say, well, you might want to download this app, which helps you understand whether or not your relationship is abusive. And then if it is, leads you through the danger assessment. And I just want to end up, and I know I need to, but one of the moms of one of the women that was killed that I interviewed here in Baltimore said that I'm supposed to say this anytime I convey data about her daughter's death. And I also I'm just catching up on my Baltimore Sun, but in Saturday's Baltimore Sun, there's a story where the headline is, and this is on page 4, the headline is "Man Killed Women Sitting on Porch on His Block, Then Confessed." Now, if you read the details of these stories, and I know, you know, who wants to read about homicide, but I try and keep track of that. And when you read it further, one of the women he killed was his fiance. And he had a conviction for a domestic violence offense on his record, and he had a protective order out against him. Yet somehow he was able to have a gun. And that's, you know, even though we have pretty good laws, he shouldn't have been allowed to own a gun. Clearly, we're not implementing those laws adequately here in Baltimore. And the other thing that's a tragedy here is he was at the home of the mother of one of his, or a child, 3-year-old, who was sent into the house with his mother before the man shot the other two women, shot and killed the other two women. And that child, even though only 3 years old, is gonna need to be able to process the fact that his father murdered someone. It was a domestic violence homicide, murdered his father's fiance. And, you know, we as a community, we need to reach out to this child. This is a highly traumatized child, even though he didn't witness it, in terms of making sure that that child gets some help in processing what happened on Saturday. Thanks.
Goodness me. A compelling presentation, Jackie, and you know, this is hard to follow, and I am glad to say we have quite a few comments and questions for both of you, because the words fail me right now. So I'm just gonna get stuck right in with some of the comments and questions, and hopefully we'll get them in the flow that they were asked. Suzanne Dutton is a geriatric nurse practitioner and asks if she has a patient with dementia who shows up, who should show up on a background check to not be able to purchase a gun. How do I get them to be listed on the background check? And she works in a military retirement home, or has done, and has actually experienced this firsthand. This question came up during Joe's presentation. I don't know if Joe would like to take that.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks so much. It's such a great question. You know, when you look at folks above the age of 65 that own guns, about 9% have dementia. And it's significant because half of people over 65 actually own guns. And when you have a loved one that gets dementia, a lot of the families don't have really any good guidance on what to do about the person's gun. So there's a couple of different like recommendations. Is like the first is like really talk, like having those families talk to their loved ones about safely transferring ownership of their guns should they become incapacitated. There's even like things like that you can do, like a gun trust, which is a legal document that outlines that process. And I think, you know, as clinicians, we're legally allowed to inquire about access to firearms, especially when a person is diagnosed with dementia. I think often experts don't do that. And so as healthcare providers, we really should be more kind of geared towards asking some of those questions. And, you know, families should ask about guns if you're along with the concerns, because there's, it's not just guns, there's a lot of other things around dementia that are critical. When you look specifically at, there are a couple different options of like what to do in this scenario. And one of the things that has been brought up is actually implementing extreme risk protection orders. Now, not all states have them. There's only about 19 states that actually have these extreme risk protection orders, which allows you to essentially, under due process, confiscate those firearms and prevent people from purchasing them. Specifically, like how you get them on the list is problematic, because this kind of goes back to the overall like loopholes within our system that are currently there, meaning the communication between both local and state government and the federal government, how they're interacting, how they're translating information. The other piece that, you know, we haven't really gotten into, but I think, you know, Dr. Campbell mentioned a little bit, is the fact that, you know, there are many ways for folks to purchase firearms, whether it's a private sale and so forth. So it's a really complex issue, and it's problematic. And I think I see that there's another question around clinicians and how they can engage, and we can talk about that and about why they maybe don't do that here in a little bit.
Okay, thank you very much. There are just so many good questions, and you know, I don't want to exclude anyone talking about your personal story. Bianca Blagg added that she had actually talked about respecting herself and others, showing a picture of how she had a black eye from being bullied, and she looked rather a broken arm. She looked happy in the picture, but she was hiding the story behind it, and she needed to get that eye contact for them to really understand. I think a lot of Joe's story relates to that point as well. On a local level, are there any partnerships or efforts for Hopkins to support community gun violence prevention efforts, organizations like Baltimore Ceasefire and Safe Streets? And I see Jackie nodding. Perhaps you'd like to take that.
Yeah, I think that the Center for Gun Violence under Dr. Webster, Ed Bloomberg, has really taken leadership there. But I know many of us support those efforts, you know, on our own. In terms of the official Hopkins support, besides through the Gun Center, I'm not sure that there is such a thing, but we could certainly, you know, those of us that are nurses, we could, you know, be a nurses addressing preventing gun violence. And, you know, the wording's not well, but good. But like with Joe's organization, I think that kind of thing would be really wonderful for us to address. And I just want to say that one of the things that we found in our study was that the men who killed themselves after they killed their female partner, that one of the things that was a hallmark of those cases is they had threatened to kill themselves prior. They were very unlikely to have ever been arrested for domestic violence or had an order of protection out against them, but they had been to a primary care provider or some sort of counselor saying, and it's, this was usually preceded by their wife leaving them or saying they're going to leave. And they would go to a healthcare provider and say, I'm distressed, I'm distraught, my wife has left me. And yet our healthcare providers, you know, although they might have assessed for suicidality, apparently did not in most of the cases, and they did not assess for gun ownership. And they also did not say, is she leaving you because you were abusing her, which, you know, might not want to ask exactly like that, but there are ways to interrogate that. And so I think our healthcare providers, both primary care and mental health care providers, need to be alert for a husband who comes because his wife is leaving or has left him, and make sure that it's not because of abuse, because what we found is that not only did he kill himself, he took his wife with him. And so in those cases, we also need to assess for the gun ownership. And that's where we could use some of those red flag laws in terms of being able to get a judge to order the removal of that gun from that known, well, not known, but from that potentially suicidal abuser.
Right.
Can I just add something about the programs that we have? In addition to the Safe Streets, there's also the Center for Prevention of Youth Violence that I believe that falls under the School of Public Health, and they use kind of an evidence-based approach to youth violence prevention in high-risk communities in Baltimore. And happy to kind of like talk offline about like the other stuff that's going on.
Okay, that's excellent. And Bianca mentions, you know, we've talked about not only how to care for patients, but both of you talked about families and neighborhoods and the emotions and stress that these events cause. And Joe, for example, having to tell a family member or, you know, unfathomable to us. So how do we prepare as health professionals for these kind of events, and can we?
Yeah, I saw that question, and I think it's so important, because actually we often, you know, you have like, there's so much trauma that exists. It's the trauma to the families, obviously, and to the communities. And it's also the trauma to the healthcare workers and the team. And in fact, you know, Albert Wu from the School of Public Health has written about, you know, this concept called the second victim, meaning us as healthcare professionals, like having that impact. And there are things called, I think it's called the RISE, resilience in stressful events. There's these RISE teams, right? And what they do is they provide confidential peer-to-peer support to the actual like employees here at Hopkins who may have experienced stressful, patient-related incidents. And, you know, I think that an adverse patient event can really have a significant impact on healthcare workers. And so this second victim concept and the trauma that occurs with those stressful situations is something that's often not discussed. And I think that this is very innovative work that helps individuals that are trained both from a psychological perspective deal with very, you know, high level of individuals that are trying to navigate these waters.
Yeah, and I absolutely agree. But also in terms of one of the things we find is the young people who use violence in our neighborhoods, who feel like, you know, they have to carry a gun to be safe, are oftentimes have been highly traumatized themselves. they have a high number of adverse childhood events, and then there's the cumulative trauma of being oftentimes in violent neighborhoods. We did a study of adolescents, and somewhere close to 80% of them had seen either a dead body in their neighborhood or someone who had been injured by violence or watched someone getting injured. And those kinds of things, especially if they happen over and over again, that's, you know, we see this cumulative trauma, and those kids need really highly skilled mental health interventions. But oftentimes they're like, I don't need counseling. You know, that whole notion of counseling or going to see a therapist is just really off their map. And if you say, you know, well, let's do some mindfulness training, they're like, what? you know, that I don't need, what is that about? That sounds like a airy fairy thingy. And, you know, so that's the kind of thing that we need to provide interventions proactively for kids who have been highly traumatized. And they have to be interventions that are appealing to an adolescent. And so, you know, that's the kind of thing I think we need to work on as a community also to prevent some of this horrific gun injuries.
Can I just add one thing to that real quick? I think Dr. Campbell's spot on. And I mean, essentially, this is, you know, what trauma-informed care is. And it's and as healthcare workers, we really have to kind of understand this concept and really bring that type of awareness of the prevalence of trauma and the long-term impacts of those effects that happen, both from a physical and emotional perspective. And, you know, I just spent the past year working for Senator Hassan, and one of the things that we worked on were these adverse childhood experiences. And this is something that, you know, the CDC did a nice report last year on this. 59% of children in the U.S. have experienced at least one adverse childhood experience. And those are actually associated with like long-term problems, things like, you know, hypertension, COPD, depression, substance use. So as we think about like comprehensively, like how do we approach care? How do we change, you know what we're doing, and how do we approach it in a way that really kind of meets the needs of the patients and the communities? That's going to be so critical. So yeah, thanks for mentioning that, Jake.
Yeah, thank you. I'm just letting everybody know we have 8 minutes left on the clock. So if we don't get to everyone's questions, we will be sure, Diana and I will copy them, make sure that both Jackie Campbell and Joe Sakran get the questions. And if you'd like to respond, we will make sure the responses get out to everyone, because there is obviously a tremendous interest in this. And really what you were both just talking about is the next question, which is looking at a more national level and what obligation we as practitioners have to weigh in on these national conversations. And they mention about policing and the scale of gun violence being greater in communities, but gun violence is also perhaps being perpetuated by this current situation. And, you know, how can we involved in these conversations that drive gun violence?
So I don't know if you're directing that to anyone, but I can start and just say a couple things. I think that's such a spot on question. Number one is we have to be involved, I think, as clinicians. It is so critical for us individuals that are taking care of patients day in and day out, and that we're a part of the solutions. I think that is something that is just really paramount. That's number one. Number two is, like, yes, like we should be involved at the national level, but let's not forget that most governing in America happens at the local and state level. And so there are like easy ways to like think about like, you know, within our own communities, you know, how do we like engage, you know, whether it's like the PTA or other task force or, you know, things that are happening through the mayor's office. Those are going to be so critical because, you know, who knows the community better than the people that are living here? And sometimes we get so focused on just what's happening at the federal level that we forget that it is also critical to you know, kind of roll up our sleeves and be active here. The policing piece is, you know, look, we have a systemic racial injustice problem in this country. I mean, that is just, I think that's clear, and that crosses different sectors, whether you're talking about healthcare or, you know, law enforcement or our judicial system. It exists, and it's something that we have to address. In 2015, President Obama had put together a task force, and they put out a report on 21st century policing. And that was created to strengthen community policing and trust among law enforcement officers and the communities that they serve, especially in light of some of the events that continue to go on. Part of that is related to police shootings, but there's a much more global and bigger picture that requires a transformative cultural change. And I think, you know, implementing and executing on some of those ideas and those recommendations is going to be critical. It hasn't been done for a variety of obvious reasons, but I think that as you think about like the next, you know, 4 years and like how you envision, you know, this country and the type of like environment you want to live in, I think it's so critical for us to be able to express ourselves by voting and making sure that we have a say in this process. So I'm going to stop there.
I absolutely agree. And I think there's room for all of us to be involved at the local level. Certainly, you know, unfortunately, Baltimore has a lot of guns around. And part of, you know, the ceasefire efforts, et cetera, and so forth, don't really, do not really specifically go after how do we remove some of these guns. Because that's, yes, it's the means, but it makes these things all too easy to happen. So I do think we have to work on those issues at all of the levels, at local, state, but also federal, not forget that. Because as I said, you know, maybe we can do some things in Maryland, but there's, as long as all of the states around us are not restricting, you know, don't require a background check, or not all the states, but some of the states around us don't require background checks to purchase guns. That's a problem. One of the things with COVID, we've seen more purchase of guns. And that is, you know, I worry that abusers are going out and buying their fifth or sixth gun. One of the things in our study is many of the abusers own multiple guns. You know, so that really worries me. And there's some places in the domestic violence field we're working on some of that, but that's a real concern that many people's knee-jerk reaction when times are troubled is to think they need a gun or more guns. And finally, the one of the traumas that too many of our young people in our cities, like Baltimore and around the country, one of the traumas they experience is trauma at the hands of a police officer. And we really have to take that into account. How, you know, traumatizing it would be to a young person to be slammed on the sidewalk for, you know, more or less walking by because there's a suspicion that because that young person is Black, they must be doing something wrong. They must, et cetera, and so forth. And the assumption that they're armed. And so therefore they have to be slammed down on the ground, handcuffed, et cetera. Now, how traumatizing is that? And we oftentimes talk about ACEs, but we don't talk about that kind of trauma at the hands of our police.
We need so much more time with both of you. You have such life impacting work, and I cannot thank you enough on behalf of Dean Davidson and the entire school for this presentation from both of you and for really giving us pause to thought to think about these issues. You will be invited back, I feel for sure, that this conversation needs to continue. And because we've run out of time, I'm just left to thank you from the bottom of my heart for an absolutely outstanding first virtual Grand Rounds. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks
thank
so much.
You. Thank you everyone for joining. I just want to remind you, in order to receive the one CNE credit for this program, you're required to complete an evaluation, which will be emailed to you. We have your email addresses from the registration. So once you've filled that out, then we will send you your 1.0 contact hour CNE. Thank you very much for joining us. Thank you, Dr. Sakran and Dr. Campbell. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.